right hand, please. I, Terry E. Branstad.
I, Terry E. Branstad.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Iowa.
And the Constitution of the State of Iowa.
And that I will.
And that I will.
Faithfully and impartially.
Faithfully and impartially.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
Discharge all of the duties.
Discharge all of the duties.
Of the office of governor.
Of the office of governor.
In the state of Iowa.
In the state of Iowa.
As now.
As now.
Or hereafter required by law.
Or hereafter required by law.
Congratulations, Governor.
Thank you very much. Lieutenant Governor, Mr. Speaker, Madam and Mr. Leader, Mr. Chief Justice, Justices and Judges, legislators, elected officials, distinguished guests, relatives, and friends. Senator Danielson, thank you for presiding today. And even though Governor Culver is not with us today, I want to thank him on behalf of Iowans for his service. Leader Utmeyer, let me congratulate you on being the first woman elected majority leader in the history of our state. We're all proud of you. Your dad, Dell, smiling down on us all today, very proud. Lieutenant Governor Reynolds, thank you for your inspirational remarks. In you, I finally met my match in energy and passion for Iowa. And I look forward to the day when I witness the swearing in of our first woman governor of Iowa. It's about time. For the past 15 months, I've traveled all over our state, from river to river, border to border, from farm to factory, from cafe to office building. It's been an experience of a lifetime to reconnect with Iowans at their jobs, schools, places of worship and play, to have a conversation with them about our state, where we are and where we want to go. And what I'd like to do today, on this, the occasion of my fifth inauguration as your governor, I want to tell you what I've learned, to make my humble attempt to distill our collective wisdom into a statement of principles, a new covenant between a state and its people. This new covenant must have as its pole star the fact that Iowa is an exceptional place. We are blessed. We are blessed with the richest resources of soil and water. We are the envy of the world, populated by hardworking, honest, and caring people that feeds and powers the world. And ignited by our ingenuity, we've only scratched the surface of our potential. Iowa stands at the precipice of opportunity greater than any time since our ancestors crossed the Mississippi to view the expanse of prairie as far as the eye could see. With the advent of open markets, a growing world middle class, and a need for sustainable solutions to the world's problems, Iowa sits at the catbird seat of history. The world is hungry for our food and biomass, envious of our technology, pining for our productivity. The economic winds, which for a century or more blew in our face, are now firmly at our back. Iowa is exceptional, and these are exceptional times. Our challenge, to seize the day. To those that say our goals of 200,000 new jobs and a 25% increase in family income is too high, I say you ain't seen nothing yet. Only wrong-headed policy choices can prevent us from entering a golden era of Iowa history. And we must start with government. It must change, lest it dampen our opportunity and squelch the individual initiative, which is our engine for growth. Our old ways of doing government's business must be radically altered to do the people's business. We must rid ourselves of the yoke of too much government, which taxes us too much, spends too much, and regulates us too much. Government must, as Abraham Lincoln once said, do only that which the people cannot do for themselves. That is a New Covenant principle number one. New Covenant principle number one. We have too much government, state, county, city, school, local, and it must be reduced. For too long, we've papered over the fact that our appetite for government exceeds our pocketbook to pay for it. My 86-year-old dad, Edward, is sitting here in the front row, and he would tell us that our eyes are too big for our wallet. And our state auditor tells us that at least 15% must be permanently eliminated from government in order to make our books balance once and for all. And I aim to make sure that we do it, and that we do it now. We will all share in the sacrifice while protecting those that need our help. But we will remove the lead boots of excess government from our economy. And without that burden, we will be able to run like the wind in the race for prosperity. Second, government must serve the people, and not vice versa. Leadership is about service, not power. I stand here again as your governor with my wonderful wife, kids, and grandkids. And I'm here because I yearn to serve. And I ask each government employee, from the clerks to the supervisors to the department heads, to never forget, it is the people who are our bosses. And we must serve each other without the compulsion of government. In 1835, a French nobleman named Alexis de Tocqueville toured the United States. and he noticed that Americans were different than Europeans. He said, "Wherever at the head of some new undertaking you see the government in France and England, in the United States you will sure find an association of people." And you know that's still true today. Everyday Iowans volunteer to make our state the wonderful place that it is to live, work, and raise a family. The Boone Hope Foundation is a great example of this. Kids were coming to school in Boone without a warm coat, or hungry, tired, sick, or worried about their family. Teachers, like many others throughout Iowa, use their own funds to help these kids, knowing that students can't learn when their basics aren't met. Those caring teachers started something called the Boone Hope Foundation. And that foundation, since 2005, has raised $129,000 from community donations to help students and their families in a time of crisis. Groceries, medical bills, eyeglasses, snow boots, and mittens have all been provided to children in need because a community cares. Let us all renew our commitment to get involved, to help the homeless, feed the hungry, minister to the sick, pray for the wayward, to make each of our communities better by stepping up and stepping out. And to those who are the most fortunate, we bear a special responsibility to extend the ladder of opportunity to those in need. We need to look no further than the record number of Iowans currently deployed in our armed forces. From Salvador Junta to Anthony Sellers, our servicemen and women protect us every day with their valor and sacrifice. We all know the story of Salvador Junta, our most recent recipient of the Medal of Honor. To all Iowans, we are busting our buttons, proud of this young Iowan for his bravery, courage, and steely resolve. I doubt that many of you know Sergeant Anthony Sellers of Burlington, but I was privileged to meet him, introduced to me by his proud father, Kent. Kent is a veteran himself, now confined to a wheelchair. But in Burlington, he was beaming when he introduced me to his son, who has completed two tours in Iraq and is now at Fort Benning preparing for another deployment. Anthony, like thousands of other Iowans, has answered the call of freedom, and he embodies the spirit of selfless service that makes our state and our country that shining city on a hill that Tom Paine wrote about over two centuries ago. Surely we can use their example as an inspiration to us all. Third, it's time to restore transparency and integrity to our government decision-making process. In Iowa, we prided ourselves on limited but quality government services. When government said it would do something, we did it, and for the right reasons. Our problems were serious but manageable, and as a people of good faith, we rolled up our sleeves and solved them. But we've gotten off track. We've overpromised and underdelivered, turning solutions into problems. Iowans deserve better. And we will get back on track with a slimmer, better managed and sustainable government that you can count on it when you need it. And it will start by opening up to the people, our budgets, briefings, and the like. Sunshine remains the best cure for what ails our government. fourth principle of our new covenant in Iowa must be a renewed commitment to provide the best education in the world. Providing Iowa's children with a globally competitive education is key to their future and the future of our state. Employers say they need a better prepared, better trained workforce. This means higher expectations for our schools. Sadly, where Iowa's educational system was once the envy of the world, today it's middle of the pack. Our young people must be able to think critically, solve problems, and communicate effectively. They need a strong background in math, science, English, and social studies. The bar is continually being raised in this knowledge-based economy. It's time to put in place reforms that are the hallmark of high-performing school systems, starting with assuring that there is a first-rate teacher in every classroom. Time to put in place reforms that are hallmarks of high-performing school systems. And as I said, we start with having the first, absolutely a top-rate teacher in every classroom. But the new year is also an opportunity for Iowans to have a conversation about how to accomplish this. How can we attract top students into the teaching profession? What do good, experienced teachers need to become effective instructors? And how do we get rid of teachers whose students consistently do not learn enough, even after those teachers have received coaching to improve? I plan to convene a summit with some of the top education leaders of our nation and state to benchmark Iowa status and lay out a plan for legislative consideration that will give our kids the best education in the world. It's not just our schools that must do more. Teaching children the value of good education is the job of parents. Instilling the importance of lifelong learning, not just by words but by example, will help families and Iowa prosper. It's time for all of us to get involved. Finally, we must celebrate success. Our tax system, whether it be property or income taxes, punishes those who create jobs that we need. That will change. Both will be reduced and simplified. Job creators will be rewarded. They are welcome here, and it's about time our tax system reflects that fact. As with our tax system, so must our attitudes towards success change. While our modesty in the face of success is sometimes charming, it can too often limit our reach. Alex Haley once said that we should find the good and praise it. In our state and in our communities, we should find success and praise it. We should reward responsible risk-taking, for it is through the creation of a spirit of entrepreneurship that all parts of our state, rural and urban, will grow. It is the ticket for bringing our sons and daughters home and giving all who live here a chance to share in our bounty. That, then, is what I learned on my travels around our state. Iowans have worked harder, sacrificed more, tightened their belts further, and endured the greatest recession since the Great Depression. And now it's time for government to do the same. It's time for a new covenant between Iowans and their government. It is a covenant that is founded upon the principles of limited government, service above self, transparency and integrity, world-class schools, and celebrating the success of Iowans. These are the principles that will guide my days as your governor. The collective of wisdom of Iowans will inspire me every day to give Iowans a government as good as the people that it serves. And I ask all of you, Republican and Democrat, liberal and conservative, young and old, to join me in that effort. No one of us has all the answers, but together we cannot fail. One long day on the campaign trail, I was visiting with some folks in a small town cafe, and one of the farmers, who appeared to be in his 80s, asked me what I wanted to accomplish by running for governor again. Well, I rattled off our goals, and then I stopped and looked at him, and asked what he felt he'd accomplished in his days. He looked at me with a twinkle in his eye, took a long sip of coffee, and shifted his feet. Well, he said, I left my farm better than I found it. When our days are done, when our time has come, we will be asked, how do we wish to measure our days? I, for one, remember that farmer in that cafe. I hope to leave the state better than I found it. If all of us would approach our days with that same sense of stewardship, we will have fulfilled our mission. With your help and Godspeed, that will be the case. And the remarkable history of an exceptional state will march on unabated. Thank you. God bless you. And God bless the great state of Iowa.